don't take it easy on me. You drove everybody else.
No, you driving y'all.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Let me get my stuff together.
Glory God.
Y'all still sitting there. Because when there's a fire, you shouldn't be able to sit down, right? But there's a fire, alarms go off. And I know at work when the alarm goes off, you know to at least exit, right? So your exit in the room today is for you to stand with a praise on your lips, a praise in your hands, a praise in your feet. You're not worshiping me, but you're worshiping the King on today. How dare us? See, last year we got ignited with the Holy Ghost. So if you were here last year and got ignited with the Holy Ghost, you ought to be able to receive that fresh fire that's in the room right now in the name of Jesus. Yes, sir. I'm here for it. Yes. Protocol has already been established. Let the Mika and more of you, a woman blazing for God, intentionally is persistent. 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 I need you to get that word on your notepad, in your mind. Persistent. Being persistent carries the idea of being determined. It is defined as continuing firmly despite opposition. Persistent. Opposition. I'm going to give that to you again. I need you to understand. We can shout all day. But I need you to understand, being persistent carries the idea of being determined. The idea, right? But it's defined as continuing firmly despite opposition. I have a few questions for you this morning. Is your blaze for God persistent? Are you standing firmly despite what it looks like, despite how you're feeling this morning, despite, I know they made you mad before you came to church this morning, but are you persistent? Yeah, don't fool me this morning. Because we show up at church and we say, yeah, I'm persistent. Oh, yes, I'm pressing. Yes, I'm praying. But when you get back to the house, I need you to understand, if you're not cautious, your persistence can intensify or destroy your blaze. Yeah, I'm here to give you the word, not to make you feel good. Everybody has a different assignment. I need you to understand, when you leave this building, when you get back home with your persistent self, it can either intensify the situation, it can destroy it. But how is that? You see, some of you are working with a Class A blaze this morning. A Class A blaze, all it takes is a little water to take you out. A misunderstanding to make you throw in the towel. You don't want to come back to church anymore. The way she looked at you make you want to go back and get in your car and get back on 45. That's a Class A blaze. And that's why some of you are still sitting, because you are with a Class A blaze. I didn't want to get in trouble, but I really wanted to show you, when you strike a match, that's a Class A blaze. So everybody's not going to leave here blazing. As a matter of fact, you didn't even show up blazing, because you're still at what? Class A.
Help me!
But there's a difference on this morning. Because when you're blazing intentionally, persistently, that Class A turns into a combust. And that combust, that's consuming fire. But let me tell you about
it. We're giving honor and praise to things and people who don't deserve it. But we need to praise and honor God, because there's no one. And something my grandmother used to say, if you haven't ran into anything in life, just keep on living. Because you will truly get an intimate and an intentional relationship with God. Amen? We want to thank Sister Hunt for that beautiful praise and worship on this morning. Next, we're going to have a scripture and welcome by our own Sister Renee Alexander. Is Sister Renee in the house? Amen. Let's give her some music as she comes up on the stage. Let's welcome Sister Renee Alexander.
intentional.
All right.
First, giving out a card to the ministers on the roster, my first lady, and to you, my family and friends. Today is the day that the Lord has made.
Yes.
And we dare act like God didn't wake
come
up.
On, come on, come on!
And we dare not act like it wasn't God. Deliverance, people, is taking place.
Right.
Everybody that started this with you cannot end your race. It's time to go higher. Wait, it's time to blaze for the Lord.
Yeah.
So you see, it's okay to step back and look at things for what they really are.
Yeah.
You can't expect for mama, daddy, sister, brother, and even your co-workers to understand your movement. And understand why your soul is on fire for the Lord. And it's okay to move along and reach for the goal, because you can't separate yourself from foolishness. You got to separate yourself from that fool. And light your own fire. And set your own tone. And blaze intentionally for the Lord. Because life don't always go according to plan. Sometimes heading in a new direction can be scary. Until you realize you're headed toward a new and exciting destination. You see, the things that used to ignite me, I now walk over. Because I'm blazing for the Lord. And just on yesterday, I was pushed to my last measurement. Nothing you have is by luck or chance. It's all due to God's grace and faith. I'm reminded, I've been down about a time or two, but he picked me right back up when I reached out to you. You brought me strength to my weakest part. You showed me the way. I'm so glad I trusted you. And now all I can say is, oh Lord, thank you for loving me. Oh Lord, thank you for giving me your grace and your mercy through my darkest days. Thank you, oh Lord, with life I can win with you, no matter what I'm going through. I just take the time sometimes to breathe and say thank you, oh Lord. I'm grateful for friends, I'm grateful for love, I'm grateful for music, and I'm grateful for the stars above. And now all I can say is thank you for loving me. Now tell me why you are not blazing for the Lord. You are welcome, so feel free to kick off your shoes, relax your feet, and prepare to blaze in God's beat.
Amen. Thank you, Mr. Alexander. Next, we have something on the program that you all can participate in, but I'm gonna do something. I'm just gonna insert something right here. Cause I know we all put on our pretty MAC makeup, we got our girdles on, all that stuff. Let me just say this, y'all look cute, so we can get that out, okay? But I want you to loosen up in here, because when these speakers come up, I want you to leave here intentionally blazing for God, okay? So I want you to get up, go greet your sister, somebody that you have not greeted. Let's just hug on each other for a minute. Can we do that for 1 minute? Let's get up, give us some music. You know, this ministry too, right? That is ministry. So we're gonna stop and pause and talk about that. The first person that's gonna come up and talk is Sister Tangela. She's gonna talk about human trafficking and domestic violence. Can we welcome our own Sister Tangela?
Good morning, Greenhouse and friends. Good morning, good morning, good morning. I'm here standing before you today to make you aware of human trafficking in this area.
Yes.
So I'm a school counselor in Spring ISD at Spring High School. And we had a presentation from a lady that came out and made us aware of human trafficking. And human trafficking in Spring is the highest in this nation. I said the highest in the nation. There is a hotel motel that is located on 1960 and also up by Cypress Wood at Spring High School, where they go and get our girls from the schools. Spring High School is one of the hottest spots for human trafficking of young adults. So how does that work? So they have boys, girls in the school that befriend our young ladies and our males also. So it's just not ladies. It's also young men as well. So what they do is they go into the school and they befriend the kids by seeking out identifiers or the students that don't look directly into your eyes. So that's how they capture their people that they're gonna pull into the game. I kind of call it a game because it's an initiation as well. So the lady told us that if you have a student or a person that can't look you in the eye, that's the first indicator of someone that can be humanly trafficked. Why? Why do you think that? Self-esteem. They don't have self-esteem. They're looking for someone to validate them or to make them feel good. So what they do is they've gotten crafty. Long time ago, they did it not as discreet. So what they do now is they invite them to a party. And then the person that is over the human trafficking is at the party. They take them shopping. They buy them nice Gucci bags, Louis Vuitton bags, nice shoes. And so the person, the kid becomes family and they feel good about themselves. So now I'm at a party, I'm thinking I'm meeting a young guy that's gonna be my boyfriend when actually I'm being initiated into human trafficking. So it was eye-opening for me because, you know, I live here out here in Spring as well. So I'm thinking, no, that couldn't be in Spring, you know, that's probably over there, you know, on Jensen or on South Main where we know the prostitution used to take place. So it's no longer called prostitution, it's called human trafficking.
Right.
And they are getting our little girls and boys and initiating them into their human trafficking ring. And once they get in, it's hard to get out. And so they're not only getting them from over here in this area. So what happens also is they go to a party, they're on social media, they invite them to a group party. They had one little girl that came from Galveston. Y'all probably heard about her. She came from Galveston, she called herself Running Away. So she came to the Spring area to some friends she had to a party. And at the party, she was introduced to some people that were supposed to help her get somewhere to stay or be her friend. But it was all a setup within the group to get her into the ring. Luckily, her parents were contacted and they were able to get her back, but that doesn't always happen. So if you have young adults, you need to be mindful of the company that they're keeping. You need to pay attention to the signs from your own kids. Some of the signs, and a little bit onto the mental health part of it. As African Americans, we kind of downplay mental health. It's nothing new. It's a big hype on it right now, but it's always been around. We need to listen to our kids. There are so many kids that come into my office that are just seeking for help. Some of the same signs that I've seen in some of my own kids, not so much as the mental health, but they could have went on that side as well.
Come on.
As parents, we need to understand that yes, mental health is within the Black race in the Black community, and you need to look for the warning signs because they're not as strong as we were, and just a little bit pushes them over the edge. So look for the signs, listen to your kids, and don't downplay any type of strange behavior or change in their attitude or their change in their what they do every day. We need to be mindful of the signs that are there. They are there. People are not just mentally ill and you have never noticed the sign. We are just not looking and listening. We're denying the fact that it may be your own child that needs some help.
Come on.
So please, please listen to your kids. Don't downplay everything. Don't say, oh, you're going to be okay. Because what I heard was, we tough, you made like that. My mother didn't do this for me. So, you know, you can put up with it. It's going to be okay. You know, you're all right. No, I'm not all right. And as adults, we're not all right. There's probably some ladies in here now that's crying out for help. And right within our church, but we're discrediting it and not looking for it or not listening for a simple cry for help. Mental health is on a rise, and it is for real. It is for real, as well as the human trafficking. I thank you for your listening ear. We have some flyers here on human trafficking. Also, I have one pamphlet that I got from the school on mental health. If you want a copy of this, just leave your number and I'll make sure that you get a copy. It's a resource guide.
Yes.
It's on mental health, it's on child abuse, sexual abuse, and all of that. It gives you the numbers and the things that you can look for abuse. Thank you for your time. Enjoy the conference, and thank you for coming out today.
Amen. Knowledge is what?
Power.
Knowledge is what?
Power.
So next, in terms of community awareness, we wanted to bring up Life Favors ER. Do we have a representative from Life Favors? Amen. Amen. Our very own Decker.
Amen. Somebody say praise the Lord.
Praise
Come on, praise the Lord.
Praise
Amen.
Lord.
I promise I'm not going to preach Life Savers this morning. Amen. But we just want to acknowledge Dr. Foyer. Her table is over here in the back. She actually was supposed to be here this morning, but she's at a conference in Dallas, and she did not make it back because she wants to be able to empower the community. So she's not just one of those doctors that have arrived and feel like she can't learn anything else. Amen. But she knows for some of us that we're getting a little older, so we need some little tweaks. So she's in Dallas figuring out the little tweaks for all those of us that's getting a little bit older. But we want to let you know that this is an emergency room that is owned by a black lady. Come on, somebody. And she's only 38 years old. I need y'all to make some noise in here. I said she's a black lady. She's only 38 years old. And she owns her own emergency room. She's not a doctor at the emergency room, but she owns. It's a big difference. Come on, somebody. So we want y'all to patronize, amen, Life Savers Emergency Room. We are located at the corner of 1960 and 249. We just want to let Dr. Foyer know we appreciate her planning in our community. I said she planning. She could have went anywhere else. She could have decided, I'm going to go to River Oak. She could have decided, I'm going to go to West Tama. But she planted herself right here in the hood. So those of us can do what? Receive a service of excellence from the top door to the back door. So put your hands together for Life Savers Emergency Room. We want to go and patronize them. Amen?
Amen. Let's go patronize Life Savers. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. So what I want you all to do in the spirit is just go ahead and buckle your seat. You're in for a treat. Next, this ministry is going to set this stage on fire. So I hope you are ready. I'm introducing none other than our youth. Gab, give them a hand of praise. Amen. Hallelujah, God. We worship you, Lord. You're worthy, God.
Everybody. Come on, lift your hands up all over the place. Tell them how much you need it.
Oh, we need God.
Y'all better back.
We need it.
burn through the night. Let it blaze to lift the tire. The fire that will never retire. Refine this fire. Let it purify our hearts. Oh, you gave the Holy Ghost and that the fire. And right on the day of Pentecost, to witness my desire. To the fire that shall not be quenched. Let it try us down within. Consume the fire. Let it burn within.
Where are my passionate people at today? Nobody's to be able to use me. And Lord, I ask you to decrease me and increase you, Lord, in me. A woman blazing for God intentionally with a passion. She is a woman that has a desire and thirst for something or someone. John 7, 37 through 38 says, if any man should thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture said, out of his belly should flow rivers of living water. Amen? Passion is defined as a strong feeling of enthusiasm or excitement for something or about doing something. Today, woman of God, I ask the question, what level is your passion for God on today? Are you on a high level that your fire is blazing? That at no cost allowing anyone or anything to compromise your walk, your love for God? How passionate are you for today?
Take your time.
Or are you the woman that is a little bit too busy with your job, your everyday life, your friends, your relationships, your family, and fitting God just in there just a little bit? How passionate are you today? God says today there is a woman that has lost her passion due to everyday life issues. She is a woman that has been tainted with some hurt, with some pain, with depression, and even rejection. John 10:10 says, the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. So all he needs to do is to come in like a thief in the night, steal your joy with some hurt, kill you with pain, and steal your passion. Woman of God, not this season. How do you keep your passion this season? I'm glad you asked. Let me introduce you to two sisters, Mary from Bethany and her sister Martha. Luke 10:38 says, through 42 tells us about two sisters named Mary and Martha. The Bible says that Jesus went to the village of Bethany one day, where he was greeted with two sisters. And everybody know when Jesus comes to town, he's coming to give you a lesson or give you a blessing. Amen? So he went to town, and he was greeted by these two sisters. And Martha was described as a Miss Busybody. She was always busy doing something. And she was more concerned about preparing for Jesus. While he was there, she was worried about cooking. She was worried about being busy. She was just worried about preparing for him. And but the scripture says that her sister in Luke 10:39 says that Mary sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. After a while, Martha got upset. She was upset that she was preparing while Mary was sitting down at Jesus' feet. And she was more concerned about preparing for Jesus. But let me tell you, Jesus is not worried about what you being prepared for. He's not worried about your everyday life. He's not worried about your degree. He's not worried about whether you are MD. He's not worried about none of that. He's worried about you sitting at his feet. He's worried about your soul. He's worried about concerned about you, not about what you doing and being busy about. Amen? So the scripture talks about that she got upset. And she went to Jesus and she told Jesus, she said, Jesus, it says that she was upset, and she told Jesus that, you know, she was complaining that Mary was not helping her. She's complaining that I'm doing all the work. I'm in here being worried, and I'm doing all the work. And why don't you tell her to come in here and help me? But Luke 10:42 says, Jesus said to Martha, but one thing is needful, and Mary had chosen that good part, which shall not be taken away from her. Amen? Mary's passion was for God. And it was so serious that it says in John 12:22, Mary got so serious about her passion that she got her alabaster box. She opened it up, and when she opened it up, she poured it over Jesus' feet. When she poured it, it got so passionate when she took her hair and she wiped his feet. Amen? That's so passionate right there. She was so concerned about Jesus. And it goes to tell in the scripture that I believe it says that she was so passionate about what she, you know, about Jesus. Martha was so upset. Now Jesus said at one time in another version, it says that she was upset that Mary was at his feet. But see, there was a reason why Mary was at his feet. See, Mary had some issues that she was going through. Mary had some things that was going on, some hurt. Mary had some pain. Mary had some rejections that somebody had did to her or had rejected her. So it was a reason why she had to be at his feet. Amen. See, I don't know about you, but every time that God takes me down to, remember when. Remember when I saved you. Remember when I delivered you. I don't know about you, but my passion goes higher. Remember when I took you out of the situation that you was in that you couldn't get out. He took me out. He was passionate about me. Why I can't be passionate about him today. Amen. Amen.
Jesus. The love of Jesus.
See, Mary had some issues where she was struggling with. And I feel like she became like the woman with the issue of blood where she had to sit at his feet. Now, at the beginning, the scripture said, come if you thirsty and come and drink, and you will never thirst again, that you will have rivers of living water. Amen. So I believe that she was thirsty and she had to get to his feet. Amen. How many of you out there are thirsty today? How many of you need to get to Jesus' feet and drink? Amen. How many of you? How many of you? Amen. Mary made three choices. The first choice Mary made was to sit and seek Jesus. Amen. Matthew 6:33 says, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things shall be added. Second, she made a choice to listen. Proverbs 19:20 says, listen to counsel and receive instructions. Amen. Sometimes you just have to sit at his feet and listen. Not sit at his feet and let it go through one ear and out the other, because it won't help you. You need to sit and seek and listen to Jesus. Amen. Third, what Mary did, she made a choice to hear the word. Luke 11:28. But he said, blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it. Amen. See, Mary made a choice. Mary made three choices. She made one choice to first seek Jesus. She made a second choice to listen to Jesus. She made a third choice to hear the word. She was a woman blazing for God intentionally, with a passion, whose heart was on fire for God. She was a woman who pressed and pushed towards what her heart desired, not allowing any distractions to get in her way. Amen. She knew that she had to plug into Jesus because he was her source and strength. Woman of God, don't allow the things of the world and the things of the world to take your passion from God. Amen.
Hallelujah. I give honor to our pastor, Pastor E.A. Deckard, and co-pastor Sandra Deckard. I truly thank God for this honor. I don't take it for granted. Ooh, my God. I don't take it for granted that he gave me breath in my body this morning. He gave me the ability to walk this morning. He gave me my talk this morning. Hallelujah. God, Father God, behind the cross, that the people may see you and not lonely fear. My God, can you give him a yoda praise on this morning? Bless your hands and forward. Can you give him a yoda praise this morning for what he's already done? Can you give him a total praise? That his hands turn forward. What he's going to do this morning. Because I believe, oh God, that you're going to do exceedingly, abundantly, and above all that we can ever ask and imagine. All that we can ever think or imagine. That's a total praise. We're going to praise you in advance for what you're going to do. We've already thanked you. What you've already done. That's a yoda praise. A total praise that we will be delivered. We will be set free. I thank you because I believe in your word. I trust in your word. And I'm waiting for your timing. A woman that's blazing for God. Intentionally praised. Oh yeah, because she has a passion. She loves God because he first loved her. Oh, we don't owe him anything. Look, he don't owe us anything. We owe him everything. Relationship with him, and you're gonna talk to him.
Yeah.
Communicating with the Father, because he wants to hear from his children. That's like any parent. You want to hear from your children. That's like God. You want to hear from his children. When you don't hear from your children, that makes them feel like you don't love them. That makes them feel like you've abandoned them. That's God. When he don't hear from you, he feels like if I don't hear from my child, you've abandoned me. You don't love me. Where's your passion? Where's your love? I need to hear from you. That's prayer. I need you to talk to me. That's prayer. I need you to talk to me. Now, there comes a time in our lives where storms may come, winds may blow. Oh, yes, the thunders of life. The storms may come, they come in many forms. Oh, yes, but is that only the time that you're going to call on him? I want him to know my voice. When I pray to him, I want him to say, oh, that's my daughter, Olivia. I'm familiar with her voice because I hear from her all the time. We have a loving relationship. Is that you? Do we know your voice? Well, I want to talk to you today about Prophetess Anna. Oh, she was a woman of God. Prayed all the time. There's a scripture in the Bible that describes her. That's Timothy. 1 Timothy 5:7, it says, speaks of a widow that describes the woman we want to talk about. It says, the widow who is truly in need and left alone puts all of her hope in God and continues. I like to home in on continue, but that means she didn't just stop. She was already praying. She already had a connection. She already had a relationship. But she continues to pray. When she prays night and day in her petitions in prayer. My God. Anna, she prayed night and day. Her story is told in Luke 2:36-37. She was a praying woman. She loved God intentionally. She prayed night and day. Prayed without ceasing. Prayed because she loved God. Prayed because she believed God. Prayed because she knew that God answered prayers. She knew the word, and she worked the word. And then when a storm came, she was storm ready. Why? Because she had a praying relationship with the Father. So when the storm came in her life, her husband died after only 7 years of marriage. Oh, I'm not going to excuse her. She had pain, but she didn't let that pain and grief cause her to bury her hope in her God. She went on, and I believe she said, Lord, you are my strength. Strength like no other. Strength that reaches to me. I will exalt the Lord.
And he will
point. God cannot lie. Call him and his word. But you got to have the word inside. You can't call up what you don't have inside. My God, a praying woman raises for God.
She pursued God as a fearless, fiery warrior with a prophetic zeal for God. Amen. Deborah, she had a special relationship with the Lord. How? Because she had and allowed God to cultivate cultivate her heart on this morning. Taking it from just being on fire to being a blazing fire. Amen. The Bible describes her as a wife, a mother, and a boss on this morning. Where my sisters at that's gifted? Where my sisters at that's talented on this morning? The Bible says that Deborah, she is the wife of Lapidoth, which makes her a woman of flames on this morning. And because they didn't have children together, guess what? She was a spiritual mother of Israel and a boss who knew when to take charge and when not to. Amen. Deborah served as a judge and she operated in the position of a prophet. Her name in Hebrew, it means bee, because she'll sting you like a bee with the word of God. Amen. Deborah, not grabbing for a platform, nor attempting to make a name for herself. Guess what she did? She died to self. Hello, somebody. She died to self only to fulfill her purpose. My God, on this morning, only to fulfill her purpose while operating in the gifts and the calling that was on her life. So I asked the question on this morning to my sisters, where my Deborah's at? Hallelujah. I know everybody ain't not going to be able to raise their hand, but I know I got some Deborahs out here in the audience, because I believe God this morning that he is raising up some Deborahs that know their purpose on this morning. He's raising up some Deborahs that's blazing for God intentionally. Oh my God, like Deborah, he's raising up some Deborahs that's pursuing him, not pursuing man, not pursuing things, but pursuing God on this morning as a wife, as a woman, as a mother, as a grandmother, as a boss on this morning, as a daughter, as a sister, as a niece, as a co-worker. My God, you didn't think God was going to touch every area this morning. God said, I'm coming to touch every area in your life on this morning. So in 2018 on this morning, God is raising you up, my sisters. You need to know that, and you need to understand that, that God is raising you up. He's looking for that one that's pursuing him. Why? Because now is the time for you to rise up like Deborah did to your first level. And your first level this morning is as a leader, just like Deborah was. Deborah was a leader on this morning. Judges 4:4 says she was leading Israel at the time. She did not allow anyone or anything to stop her from being in the position that God called her to. To my sisters on this morning, no matter the circumstances that you may be in, no matter the trials that you may be faced with, no matter the treatment that you may be going through on this morning, don't stop pursuing God. Amen. As a leader, you are positioning yourself to be used by God. Amen. Because it's not about nobody else. It's about what God has for you on this morning. And it's about what God is doing through you on this morning. Habakkuk 2:1 says, I will station myself. I will wait to see how the Lord will reply to me. As a leader who pursues God, amen, you are to lead by example with charisma, my God, because of the blaze that's burning on the inside of you. Guess what? It shows you who's living on the inside of you this morning. A leader is a humble servant like Deborah who sits under the palm tree, the Bible says, which means, my sisters, you are to sit, my God, under the glory of God to receive a word from God so that you can operate under his anointing. Oh God, my God, by faith and not fear on this morning. My sisters, my God, a woman blazing for God. Intentionally, she pursues God and she rises up like Deborah to her next level, which is her second level as an iron sharpener. My God, this morning, Judges 4:5 says the people of Israel, they came to her to have her to decide cases for them and to settle matters that were going on between them, that was going on amongst them. The Bible says she stood in the place of Ramah and Bethel. On this morning, my sister, God wants to use you. He wants to use you as a spokesman. He wants to use you as his mouthpiece. He wants to use you as his iron sharpener on this morning. As an iron sharpener, your body is his house, and out of your mouth shall be his word. Proverbs 27:17 says, as iron sharpens iron, so a friend sharpens a friend on this morning. When you see your sister looking a little weaker, oh my God, just rise up, go, my God, and touch her in the name of Jesus. When you see your sister looking a little dull, rise up, my sister, and be an eye sharpener and go and sharpen her on this morning. My God, 2 Timothy 1:6 says, that is why I remind you to store up the gift of God to help God's gift grow into a fire. Just like Deborah, my sisters, you ought to sharpen others by giving them strategies. By giving them strategies on how to defeat the enemy. Amen. This way, you're helping her keep her sword sharp and not allowing it to go dull. Because sometimes it do go dull. But as an iron sharpener knows how to rise up when they see their sister looking a little more and say, hey, let me sharpen you a little bit more. Oh, my God. An iron sharpener knows how to leap over hurdles. An iron sharpener knows how to go through mountains. An iron sharpener knows how to go through the storm, and even when they in the lowest lows of their life, they know how to go through the valley this morning. Hallelujah. Jesus. A woman blazing for God intentionally. She pursues God and she rises up to her third level as an atmosphere changer. My God. As I was looking at our sister while she was doing praise and worship, you talking about an atmosphere changer. That's all I can see. She is an atmosphere changer. So this morning, my sisters, just like Deborah, you need to rise up to your third level. Oh my God, and be an atmosphere changer. Judges 5:12, the Bible declares, wake up, Deborah. Wake up. Wake up. Wake up, my sisters. Some of us are sleeping right now. Some of us are napping right now. But the Bible says to wake up, my sisters, this morning as an atmosphere changer who knows that their victory is now. My God, an atmosphere changer. She is not a thermometer. She is like a thermostat who senses in the spirit when the temperature needs to be changed. Woman of God, you may be surrounded around some circumstances. You may be surrounded around some conditions. There may be some things that's hindering you. There may be some things that's stopping you from growing. But I tell you on this morning, go stand up, rise up, and be an atmosphere changer. My God, because it's affecting your growth. The longer you sit and don't rise up, guess what? It's affecting your growth. It's affecting your family. It's affecting your finances. It's affecting your marriage. It's affecting your children. It's affecting your career. It's affecting your business. Guess what? It's affecting your ministry. Guess what? It's affecting your church. I need you to rise up on this morning and be an atmosphere changer. All you gotta do is rise up and use the word this morning. Romans 4:17 says, as it is written, all those things be not as though they were. When you see something going on in your household, rise up on this morning, my sister. Open up your mouth and say, Lord, I love you. Lord, I praise you. Lord, I magnify you. Lord, I bless your name. Lord, no matter what I'm going through, no matter how it feels, I still give you glory. I still bless your name. I still clap my hands. I still lift up my hands. I still will open up my mouth and give you glory this morning. I'm talking about an atmosphere changer. That when she sees the enemy in her house, when she sees the enemy in her church, she know how to shift. Oh my God, this morning, when she sees something not going right, she know how to move. When the Holy Ghost say move, when she sees something not going right, she knows how to open up her mouth and say, devil, this is not your house. I come to evict you on this morning. I come to tell you that as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, my atmosphere changes it. It's time for you to rise up. It's time for you to get up. You've been sitting down too long. I hear the Lord this morning. He said you've been sitting down too long. It's time for you to get up. And don't just get up. Open up your mouth and do what you know you ought to do. The Bible says, praise ye the Lord in the name of Jesus. Shift the atmosphere. Not only were you shifted, but you were lifted with your praise. And in conclusion, a woman blazing for God intentionally, she pursues God. And she rises up like prophetess Deborah as a leader. As an orange sharpener. As an atmosphere changer. And when you do this, my sister, the peace of God will rest upon you. And when you do this, my sisters, everything that's connected to you, they should have peace. According to Judges 5 and 31, when Deborah rose up as an atmosphere changer, the Bible says that so the land was at peace.
My God.
And when you go over into the New Testament, the Bible says in John 14, 27, Jesus says, I leave you with my peace. I give you my peace. And I do not give it as the world gives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
I don't know if you get it, but it's one sermon. Four people for one sermon this morning. Hallelujah. Ah, Kendrick, you're going to take it easy on me. You drove everybody else.
No, you're driving, y'all.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Get my stuff
together. Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Jesus. There's something about that blaze. Y'all still sitting there. Because when there's a fire, you shouldn't be able to sit down, right? But there's a fire, alarms go off. And I know at work when the alarm goes off, you know to at least exit, right? So your exit in the room today is for you to stand with a praise. A praise on your lips. A praise in your hands. A praise in your feet. You're not worshiping me, but you're worshiping the King of the day. How dare us? See, last year we got ignited with the Holy Ghost. So if you were here last year and got ignited with the Holy Ghost, you ought to be able to receive that fresh fire that's in the room right now in the name of Jesus. Yes, sir. I'm here for it. Yes. Protocol has already been established. Less of me, God, and more of you. A woman blazing for God intentionally is persistent. 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 I need you to get that word on your notepad, in your mind. Persistent. Being persistent carries the idea of being determined. It is defined as continuing firmly despite opposition. Persistent. Opposition. I'm going to give that to you again. I need you to understand. We can shout all day. But I need you to understand, being persistent carries the idea of being determined. The idea, right? But it's defined as continuing firmly despite opposition. I have a few questions for you this morning. Is your blaze for God persistent? Are you standing firmly despite what it looks like? Despite how you're feeling this morning? Despite, I know they made you mad before you came to church this morning, but are you persistent? Yeah, don't fool me this morning. Because we show up at church and we say, yeah, I'm persistent. Oh, yes, I'm pressing. Yes, I'm praying. But when you get back to the house, I need you to understand, if you're not cautious, your persistence can intensify or destroy your blaze. Yeah. I'm here to give you the word, not to make you feel good. Everybody has a different assignment. I need you to understand, when you leave this building, when you get back home with your persistent self, it can either intensify the situation, or it can destroy it. But how is that? You see, some of you are working with a Class A blaze this morning. A Class A blaze, all it takes is a little water to take you out. A misunderstanding will make you throw in the towel. You don't want to come back to church anymore. The way she looked at you make you want to go back and get in your car and get back on 45. That's a class A blame. And that's why some of you are still sitting, because you are with a class A blaze. I didn't want to get in trouble, but I really wanted to show you when you strike a match. That's a class A blaze. So everybody that's not going to leave here blazing. As a matter of fact, you didn't even show up blazing, because you're still at what? Class A.
Help me!
But there's a difference on this morning. Because when you're blazing intentionally, persistently, that class A turns into a combust. And that combust, that's consuming fire. But let me tell you about that consuming fire. It will consume the wicked or will purify the righteous. That's not up to me, that's up to you this morning. So you can be consumed either way, whether you wicked or righteous, but the feeling is different this morning. I'm just here to tell you the truth.
Help me!
I hear you saying, Christy, it's been a little rough for me. Yeah, me too. So I haven't been persistent in my walk, me neither. So I understand. Life will happen, but how, despite the unnecessary roughness? Because we're making excuses. There is some unnecessary roughness. It happens. You're going to be shooken. You're going to be broken. You're going to be hurt. Somebody's going to not like you. That's unnecessary roughness. But even doing the unnecessary roughness, I need you to be blazing.
He cannot blaze anyway.
And even while you're blazing, this unnecessary roughness, we always say, oh, I can't make it. You know, women, we're emotional. But you are suitable and you equipped. Even with your feelings hurt. Hebrews 13:21 says, God equips us with everything that we need to do his will. So your name should change. Your name is now Miss Persistent.
I'm suitable.
You are suitable. And equipped. I just come to encourage you this morning. Because if you are intentionally persistent in God, your circumstances and your countenance ought to look different. If you got a mirror in your purse, pull it out real quick. I'm going to show you how you're supposed to, because I know I'm cute. Look in your mirror. Get your mirror. You got your mirror? See, your countenance ought to be different. Because it's not what you're seeing in the physical. See, I'm cute, but when something is not right, my eyes are red. When something is not right, my heart may be broken. You can be cute and still be walking over. You can be cute and still hurt on the inside. But when you're blazing for God intentionally, your countenance needs to be different. Did you get a chance to look at yourself this morning? And the reason why I want you to look at yourself, because we're quick to say we're a dying piece or his side piece. But when your countenance is different, when it's intentional with God, you should now be a ten-along blaze. So then you went from class A all the way to a 10. I'm going to show you it ain't got nothing to do with your waist size. It has nothing to do with your breast size. It has nothing to do with your hip size. But when you can go from a class A to a 10-along fire, it's something bad about you, girl. But that's only because you're intentionally persistent this morning. And I'm going to tell you about this blaze. See, a 10-along blaze, you can see it. I see you. You see me. It's notable. It's noticeable. You can see it from afar. You can see the smoke as they're walking. You can see the smoke as they're talking. You can see the smoke as they're praying on this morning. And not only can this 10-along blaze have you look at it, but if you're not cautious, it'll take your breath away. That's why we're able to mesmerize men on this morning. I'm trying to help you. Because it'll take your breath away. That 10-along blaze. But I need you to use what God has placed on your spirit and not mesmerize the man, but get him in the presence of the Father on this morning. Jesus. Now the persistence of this blaze, we're going to give it a name. It's called the working fire. The working fire. Are you determined to work your faith this season? Because for the Bible scholars, you should already know that persistence is equivalent to your faith. Amen? Now the persistence should put you in the presence of God, not man. And once you're in his presence, you can demand the ear to his request. Not only will it position you, but it will make you seek God and not wait to be sought. We're so quick to say, he needs to come get me. I'm not going to get him, but we're seeking the Father this morning. 1 Chronicles 16:11 tells us to seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face continually, just like the Canaanite woman. You will find her story in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 7, verses 24 and 30, and Matthew chapter 15, verses 21 through 28. She persistently sought the Lord. She was desperate for Jesus to heal her daughter that was demon-possessed with demons. She was vulnerable. If you read her story, you will notice that Jesus handled her roughly. The disciples treated her bad. They wanted to get rid of her. It startled her. That was startling you too. But in spite of the opposition, she persistently interceded for her daughter's healing. Now in between the exhaustion, the tears, the anxiety, she knew that quitting was not an option. You do know that quitting is not an option, right? So in between when you're tired, in between going through, in between being hurt, in between being confused, some of us abused on this morning, quitting is still not an option. Yeah, even though quitting was not an option, she still had persistence as her new name, aka the woman of faith. But all she knew was to call out the name of Jesus until she was answered. She was determined and she stood firmly. Are you persistent? Because if you're persistent, no matter what comes, no matter what goes, you're gonna stand there, you're gonna sit there, you're gonna get to the altar, you're gonna fall on your face, you're gonna get on your knees, and you're gonna call the name of Jesus until he heals you. I can hear our prayer. Father, the son of David, I know you by name, just as you know me. I know you to be a healer this morning, just as you heal the Gentiles. I know you to be a comforter, just as you comforted her. I know you to be a protector, Father. You are the great physician. Heal my daughter. She needs to be touched by you. I know I'm not favored by man, but I'm favored by you, God. Heal my daughter. I'm tired of the pain. I'm tired of being hurt. I'm tired of the backlash. I'm tired of people talking about me. Heal me, God. Deliver me from evil. But it's in your prayer. She interceded just like that. She went before the Father just like that. She didn't have a pity party just like that. She opened her mouth. She told God what she needed. She demanded his ear. She didn't care what everybody else had to say. She didn't care about being a woman. She opened her mouth. She didn't care about being a single parent. She opened her mouth. She didn't care about having three baby daddies. She opened her mouth. She opened her mouth. All it takes is for us to open our mouth. And when you open your mouth, I need you to be persistent in your request. Stay before him. Have him listen to you. Make the disciples listen to you. Make the armor bearers listen to you. I'm going to minister from the A to the E. I'm going to stay before the Father until he hears me. Jesus. And because she stayed there, it was a test. And sometimes God is just testing us, just to see if we're going to come and sit at his feet, just to see if we have enough sense to come to the person that makes the first and the last decision. But when he told her it was a test, he had already healed her daughter. And it wasn't because she was cute. It wasn't because she was a dying piece. But it was because of her faith. At this very moment, you can see the significance of being persistent. Being persistent increases your passion. She had the love she had for her daughter was greater than the opposition she faced. Your persistence increases your praying. She prayed without ceasing and made sure she got to Jesus and fell at his feet. Your persistence increases your pursuit. She stayed in the position of prayer and kept going forward until she heard from Jesus. how she was disqualified. Y'all have to remember, Jesus was in another region. She was from another place. Jesus was in another region. She was in another place. So she thought she was disqualified, but her persistence qualified her. I don't care if you're from Fifth Ward, Third Ward, Cashmere Garden, Foodywood, South Park. What's for you is for you. All y'all ain't been living in Spring all your life. So whatever hood you came from, even go to the suburb. But what's for me is for me. I am qualified. You are qualified. God has the papers. And he says so. Don't let nobody tell you you're not capable of doing nothing. You are qualified. You are equipped. You are suitable. This is your time. This is your season. You better tell your homegirl I'm qualified, boo. Degree if you want to. I taught the person that got the degree. Tell her you qualified. Yeah. She's an MP right now. Yeah. She didn't call a few doctors. Jesus. You qualify. You are qualified. You are qualified. You better believe that your persistence qualifies you.
You qualified.
Get that from. I'm qualified, boo. Your persistence. Uh-huh. It makes you speak up. And you don't have to be silent. Y'all need to learn that when you read the Bible, ask God who is he talking to and what time was he talking to them and what the situation was for. That situation specific. Women of God, open your mouth. She spoke up. Don't let nobody tell you to shut up. If the word of God is in you, you gotta come out, bring it out. Preach in your living room. Preach in your bathroom. Preach on your balcony. Preach in your own car. Make you a pulpit. Strength and you've broken up. We're gonna have a party. Your persistence prevails. And if you know what prevail means, that means victory is in the house on this morning. Stay the course, my sister, because there's victory, not in yourself, but in Jesus. You will not be defeated. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. I need you to get that in your belly. You will not be defeated. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. We don't need to walk back in this church another time talking about we're defeated because he left you. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. You're not defeated because you don't have no money. That's bad stewardship. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. You want people to preach and sweat all day. I need you to get the word and apply it. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. And if you're your own weapon, you better tell yourself, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. And why wouldn't it prosper? Because the joy of the Lord is your strength. I know we're strong black women. We're every woman. But the joy of the Lord is your strength. I don't know about you, but I'm just crazy enough to believe, not just today, but to believe it gets rough. You know, I ain't gonna lie to you. I have good days, bad days, not so good days, horrible days, but the joy of the Lord is still my strength. But if I just put my trust in Jesus, I can't trust Coco. She might decide to leave me and go You know, we're real impatient, but your persistence will make you want to be patient. And when you start being patient, Isaiah 40 and 31. And if you have your Bibles or your Bible app, I just need you to meet me there. And I'm closing. Isaiah 40 and 31. If you trust God, if you remain persistent, if you stay with your passion, if you keep praying and pursuing the Father on today, Isaiah 40 and 31 says, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They will mount up. He didn't say you were going to sink, but they will mount up with wings as eagles. They will mount up with wings as eagles. They will run and not be weary. They will walk with your cucumbers, and you're still not going to faint. But the only way that's going to happen is you just wait. Wait, oh Jesus, keep your passion, but wait, oh Jesus, keep praying, but wait, oh Jesus, continue your pursuit, but wait, oh Jesus, and with your persistence, we're gonna wait, oh Jesus.
Ever been there where everything seems to go wrong? Nothing you did seemed to work out. Cause you tried to do it on your own. Friends and family,
come on, man of God.
They didn't understand that all things works in God's plan. So I learned to trust in God, to step right in and work it out. Nobody, nobody did this, ooh, but God.
Can I get a witness in here?
Come on, man of God. That needs healing in your life. for you. And it looked like the enemy trying to make you look like you never reach it. Tell somebody, God's getting ready to do something. Let's go blow your mind. Tell them that God's getting ready to do this. I don't care how long you've been waiting on it. You gotta hang on in there. Don't give up. Don't give in. It's many of you in here that God said that your business will never go under. Because of what he's already promised you. And the enemy's trying to pull little things in the way that tell you that it'll never grow. But the devil is a liar. Tell somebody, I know what God did for me. I know how he moved on my behalf. I know how he gave me favor.
If he would come, but there are some women here. If you are a pastor, I just want you to wave your hand for me this morning. Amen. Because I don't want to start calling names, but it's some very special ladies, and y'all can do better. I didn't hear nobody clap for them. Amen. And now if you are a minister of the gospel, you took time out of your Saturday, and you here this morning, raise your hand. Amen. And if you like Lady Decker, just a good old Sunday school teacher, amen, and God decided to call you to do something else, where my Sunday school teachers at? Wave y'all hand. Amen. We love the Lord. But there are two special ladies that are here with us on today. Amen. They worship God with us in Vegas. And I know they feel like I don't have to do it, but I thank God that, you know, God connect you with people for a reason. Amen. You know, God connected me with Sister Joy many, many years ago, and I'm so humble and grateful that she is one of my big sisters in the ministry, amen. And every year, Joy takes us, amen, to Las Vegas, and I know they say everything that goes in Vegas ought to stay in Vegas, but we decided to bring some stuff out of Vegas with us this morning, amen. So we got two sisters here from Vegas, and I just want them to stand this morning, amen. Sister LaShonda Jackson and Minister Woods, can y'all make some noise? They all the way from Vegas. Oh, come on, Houston. Y'all can do better than that. They done been to the mountaintop. Come on, they done stomped down the mountain with us. I need y'all to open up your mouth and act like you know this morning. Hallelujah. I am just so grateful that y'all are here this morning. Y'all just don't know, y'all have made my heart glad on today. I'm grateful, I'm thankful for you being here on today. Amen. Pastor Declan, if you come on here, y'all, he haven't stopped working, amen, since he started, amen, or we started on yesterday, amen. They were here decorating, and he was right here with them, amen. Can y'all make some noise for the man of God of this house? Let me take y'all, always want me to go get them. Can y'all make some noise for the man of God? I can't never be trash. Cute and sanctified and stuff. Y'all like Justin Drive, don't y'all? Y'all like her, amen? So one more time, can y'all open up your mouth, stand to your feet for none other than E.A. Decker!
Can I give God a shout of praise in this house? Give God a shout of praise in this house. Before I do what I've been assigned to do on this morning, won't you do yourselves and do the Holy Spirit a great big favor? And let's honor the woman of God in the presence of co-pastor Sandra Denny. Yeah. Personally, thank all of the workers, everyone who volunteered, everyone who served up to this point.
Yes.
They left out a very critical part of the worship experience on this morning. And that's the opportunity to worship through giving.
That's right.
In the Bible, there was this beautiful lady, but on the outside, she had a complicated situation. We know her as Leah. And the Bible says she was trying her best to get this brother's attention. And so she began to give him babies. The first baby, she said, the Lord blessed me with a son to give this man because of my story, but that didn't fulfill her. Then she had another boy and said, because I am unloved, but that didn't feel her. And then she said, because of my harsh treatment, I'll try it again, but that didn't fulfill her. And something interesting, the Bible says, we get ready to prepare to give. Just, then she had another son, and she named him Judah. Judah means praise. And then the Bible says that she stopped having sons. Because once she got to a point of intimate worship with God, once she got to a point where it didn't matter if the man said yes or no, if people approved her on the outside, once she connected with God, she was able to give birth to worship. And once she started worshiping, she felt fulfillment. And what am I saying this morning? No matter what shape, form, or condition you came in, as a dime piece, side piece, his piece, that piece, when you learn how to worship within yourself, when you learn how to ignore your circumstances, situations, what they say about you, and when you learn like the woman with the alabaster box, just worship him for just the way you are. You may have found you on Justin Street or a Greens Road or wherever you found it. Just learn how to worship him. And the purest sense of worship is when you open your alabaster box and worship him through giving. Regardless of where you're from, regardless of who you are, when you learn how to serve through giving, when you learn how to worship through giving, when you learn how to love through giving, you'll find your place with God is sealed and complete. You can intentionally be lit for the Lord. So I'm asking you this morning to dig in your alabaster box. There are several ways you can give this morning. You can sit at your seat and give from text. You can text at 77977. Real simple. 77977. The word in all caps. Greenhouse. GRENHOUSE. You can sow that way. Or you can simply, wherever you are, get your seat in your hand.
Yeah.
And bring it to the altar. And we're asking this morning that when you sow your seed, you're sowing into the vision of not just the Genesis Women's Ministries Conference, but you're sowing into the vision of a ministry who's dedicated to bring about change in this city and this community. You cannot be in Houston and not see the work of the Lord over this ministry. So every dime that goes into this ministry, whatever the purpose, it goes to blessing this city, this community. Because when you need us, we'll answer your call. So when you sow this morning, you're sowing to more than just a women's conference. You're sowing to a godly assignment. So I'm challenging you. I'm challenging every woman here this morning to open up your alabaster box and go as deep as you possibly can and watch the overflow of what God does. When a woman of God comes to deliver the message in just a few minutes, the seed you're sowing right now will ignite and grow and reach you before you get home. Just trust the word of God on this morning. So if you're ready to give, won't you stand where you are? If you're ready to give, won't you stand where you are?
Amen. First lady made it back in. Yeah, amen. And we just thank God for her and her husband this morning. Can y'all make some noise for them? They are so humble. My God, y'all, when you find humble pastors, because they still pastors. And some of y'all done got it twisted. I say they still pastors. God just allowed them to sit with us for a season. Amen. Amen. So I thank God for them. And when I tell you that the reason I know they just wonderful people, Brandon, can you just stand up? This is one of the humblest babies you will ever meet. Amen. This is their son, and he is just so humble. And that the Bible says you know a person by what? It's fruit, amen, that they bear. That's good fruit right there, amen. And I'm going to read her bio, but it's more personal to me to talk about who you are right now, amen. I know that she Dr. Marks, amen, but she a wife, she a mother, amen. She's a friend, she's been a co-worker, amen. And I just honor you on today for sitting with us for a season. I'm grateful that God allowed us to connect, amen. And Lady Cook had to leave. I told you God have a divine way of doing things, of orchestrating things, because I didn't know the Marks, but Lady Cook introduced us, amen. So I'm grateful to Lady Cook, because relationship mean everything to me. Ask Lady Caraway. It means that. See, when I'm your friend, I'm your friend for real, amen. I'm the ride or die chick, whether I'm in Houston or whether I'm in Vegas. Anybody that know anything about me, they know I'll fight for you here, I'll fight for you across town, amen. So you are truly my friend, my kindred sister, and I thank God for you this morning. And as she get ready to make her way, amen, to the stage, her bio says, having served 11 years, amen, as a healthcare profession. So how many of you know we already connected in the spirit? Because many of y'all didn't know she was, amen, a healthcare profession. Y'all didn't know she was a nurse, amen. And not only is she a nurse, but she's a doctor, amen, that knows the importance of both spiritually and natural health. So it's important. Your physical body is important to her, but your spiritual body is important to her. And as the Holy Ghost get ready to move in here in a few minutes, I need you to make your heart ready to receive, amen, for the teacher that's going to be down on the inside of us. I need you to make your hearts ready. Come on, Pastor Hunt. Amen. For the preacher that's going to come forth out of her. I need you to make your way ready and be your minds and your hearts ready. Amen. For the prophetic that's going to be down on the inside of her. Come on, you're already clapping. Come on, you're already. Come on, where my atmosphere changes. You're already setting the atmosphere. Come on, somebody say, I want to receive. I came to receive. Somebody say, preach, Lady Moore. Come on, somebody say, preach. You got to put a demand in the atmosphere. I came that I may be whole. I came that I may be set free. Come on, somebody put it in the atmosphere. How many of you came because you need a word from the Lord on today? Come on, you got your appetizer. But how many of you came for the main course on today? Come on, you got to clear your plate. Clear your plate. Somebody say, get ready, get ready. Oh, come on, get ready, get ready. Are you playing with God on today? I need some people that are hungry. I need some people that are thirsty.
Wherever you go, we'll go.
Gotta be where you are.
Whatever you say, we'll say.
Gotta be where you are.
Say, let's lift your hands and begin to love him. Glory to your name, Father. We thank you, Lord God, for the gathering of the women today, God. We bless your name, God, for this divine appointment, God. I thank you right now, God, for your presence that saturates this place. God, I pray that you would sit on us, God. Sit on us, God. Move by your spirit like you never have before, God. In the name of Jesus, heal, save, set free, and deliver, God. In the name of Jesus, God, I ask that you would anoint the ears and the hearts of your people to receive the word that you have for the church today. God, I give your name the glory. God, I give your name the honor. God, I worship you, God. Not only with the fruit of my lips, but with my life, Lord. I honor you, God. We thank you, Lord God, that I will decrease and you will increase, God. Speak through me, God. Speak through me, God. Touch the heart of a woman that came here broken today, God. In the name of Jesus. Touch a child that's broken here today, God. In the name of Jesus, God, we decree and we declare it that not one person that's here, male nor female, will leave here the same. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand. Glory to God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I bless God for everything that they said. Y'all talked about appetizers. They preached heaven down, y'all. Glory to God. But they prepared because there was so much going on. Sister Christy, I heard that last scripture just before you got up, and I praise God for that. Glory to God. So everything is what God wanted today. It is not by chance that you made it to Greenhouse International today. It is not by chance that God told you to come to the Genesis Women's Conference. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We're going to go to the book of Genesis. Glory to God. Hallelujah. We're going to start from the beginning, but let me tell y'all a little bit of story first. It is amazing to me that at the very start, even before this year started, Genesis kept coming up in my life. When I tell you, I literally saw Genesis everywhere. So much so, God gave me a Genesis car. Then I get here in January and it's Genesis Women Conference. Our Genesis Women's Ministry here at Greenhouse. And I said, Lord, what are you doing? Telling me what's going on about the Genesis? What is going on? And I just begin to see it more and more and more. So I can't help but go to the beginning. Glory to God. So we're going to go to Genesis. Hallelujah. Chapter 2, verse 18. I'm going to try to calm down because I'm telling y'all, the Lord is doing great and mighty things here. I'm telling you now, there are things that have been imparted even while you've been sitting at your seat eating your lunch. There have been things that have been ignited in your life even while you were sitting there and listening to the word that's been coming forth. Hallelujah. So Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. And the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him an helpmeet for him. Verse 20, and Adam gave names to all cattle, to the fowl of the air, to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helpmeet for him. And the Lord caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam. And he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord had taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she came out of man. So I want you to know that you are a man with a womb. Wow. Woman. We were brought on the scene to be problem solvers. Wow. There was a problem with Adam. He was alone, and God said, it is not good for man to be alone. So God brought her on the scene to be a problem solver. God called it and pulled a rib out of Adam and made a woman. God pulled a solution in a woman.
In a woman.
Verse 21 says she was created out of the rib of Adam. And y'all know I'm a nurse, so I got to go there medically. The ribs serve a purpose to protect the lungs, the heart, and other internal organs of the thoracic. That's this up here. So when you don't have a rib, anything can hit you and cause damage to your internal organs. So not only was she pulled from the rib, but she is a protector of those that she comes in contact with. That's why when you see a mama, you don't want to mess with her children. You don't want to mess with her children.
You better.
She gonna protect what's hers. You don't want to mess with her man either. She gonna protect what's hers. Glory to God. You know, a woman has power to multiply anything you give her. The man gives her seed, and she gives him life.
You take it, Mark.
A woman can be given a couple of potatoes and a sausage and make a complete meal. She can take a few dollars and stretch it. I've been asked so many times, you hot money? No. But a woman will multiply whatever you give to her.
She can make it multiply.
A woman is the backbone of her family. When God wanted to enter the earth, he used a woman, Mary, to bring forth Jesus. When God wanted to save a nation, he used a woman, Esther. When God wanted to infiltrate wealth, he used a woman, Ruth. And if I was to take a topic today, and I know it's not going to completely make sense to you right now, but I promise you it's going to make sense later. And that topic would be, show them who you are. I'm reminded of a day I was sitting around the house and I had a vision and the Lord let me see the enemy looking at me so strangely. And I said, God, why is the enemy looking at me like that? He said, because he sees what you don't see. He said, turn around. And I turned around and God showed me the backing of heaven behind me. So the devil knew what was behind me, but many times we don't know that we got the backing of heaven because it seems invisible. It seems like we don't see it. We don't feel it in the times that we need it the most. But God says, the enemy sees what you don't see. You've got the backing of heaven. Glory to God. Hallelujah. When you look at the topic of show them who you are, it is so profound. And I'm going to give it to you the way the Lord gave it to me. I know many of us probably went out and saw Black Panther.
Amen. Amen.
When the king was actually defending his crown, and it looked like he was going down, and he was about to be defeated. He was on the ground and going out. He heard a very familiar voice in the background, and she said, show him who you are! So when that hit me so hard, the Lord says, that's what I'm telling you.
Yeah, that's good.
I'm saying it with such a silent scream in the background. Because many times we think God's just going to cook up over our head and make us do. He's not that kind. He's a gentleman. He will suggest you do something, but he's going to let you make the decision. I want to tell you what happens when you don't know who you are. Though Eve was made perfect, she was beguiled. The same woman who had it all together was conned. In the third chapter of Genesis, the serpent asked, hey, did God tell you you could not eat of every tree of the garden? And Eve said, yeah, we can eat of the trees of the garden, but just not the one in the midst of the garden. If we touch it or eat it, we will die. The serpent said to the woman, You're not gonna die. Eat it. God knows that when you eat it, you will see as gods, and your eyes will be open, knowing good and evil. God always intended for us to know good and evil, but not the way it came.
My God.
Not the way it came. It came through sin that we begin to know good and evil. That's how he does it. The enemy suggests. He has the power of suggestion. Here you're looking. The devil will suggest many things. You know how many times you done heard your sister say, girl, I'm trying to find myself. He will have you looking here, looking there, and have you everywhere. Glory to God. Eve lost sight of who she was. When a woman is not aware of who she's supposed to be as a helpmeet, she ultimately becomes the demise of men. Look at Delilah. She was a beautiful woman, but instead of adding to what Samson had, she subtracted from him. She caused him to lose his strength, to lose what God gave him. She used his weakness for her personal gain. Look at Jezebel. She was a woman of strategy, but she used her strength for the kingdom of darkness. Proverbs 26:6-26. It says, for by means of a whorish woman, a man is brought to a piece of bread. Not knowing who we are as a woman and the power we possess causes us to look for love in all the wrong places, thinking that eventually we will find what we're looking for. When you don't know who you are, you will walk away from a family that you're supposed to be the structure for. When you don't know who you are, it will have you be addicted to pills, seeking relief that will never last. When you don't know who you are, it will have you looking for a lifetime of love in a moment of temporary satisfaction in a one-night stand.
Wow.
When you don't know who you are, it will have you turning up bottle after bottle and seeing he turned water into wine. Newsflash, it was not fermented. It was non-alcoholic. It was in its purest form.
My God. Come on and make it plain.
When you don't know who you are, it will have you questioning your identity, your sexuality, and your very existence. Look at the world today. Many of the women that we see have gone into homosexuality and different other promiscuous sexual sins. Most times it's because they feel like they don't know who they are. I don't know who my daddy is. He didn't tell me how to really be who I'm supposed to be.
Jesus.
Glory to God. Not knowing who I was had me pregnant at 17 for a man who cared nothing about me or my baby.
Come on, woman of God.
A preacher's kid.
Come on.
A baby out of wedlock and a youth pastor.
Come on, woman of God.
I didn't know if anybody would want me. I didn't know who I was, being convinced by my own self-condemnation that I would have nothing to say to anybody because of how badly I messed up.
Jesus. Jesus.
You know, nobody has to condemn you. The devil makes sure you condemn yourself.
Yes.
You ain't got nothing to tell nobody. Look at you. Look at your life. And in my thought process of thinking, ain't nobody gonna want to marry me. Baby, ain't nobody gonna want no ready-made family. But my God sent was right around the corner. Glory to God. Hallelujah. When we look at the word, hallelujah, condemnation, Romans 8:1 says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of spirit of life is in Christ Jesus,
have made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit. And I know that was a little wordy, so let me break it down for you. Condemnation comes from the root word condemn.
Right.
It means to pronounce to be guilty, sentenced to a punishment. You will never become who you're supposed to be, beating yourself up over who you were.
Wow.
You gotta say that again.
Who you were.
Your past mistakes does not define your destiny. God will take your mess and use it. There is a testimony in you. Something you went through was not just for you. It was for the next woman that needed to know how to come through. It was for the next woman that needs to know that I'm here, sister, to tell you you can make it. I'm here to tell you that no matter what comes or goes, you can make it. But if you're sitting there quiet, if you're sitting there letting the devil convince you, you don't have nothing to say. You keeping your testimony from those who need it.
Jesus.
Intended for us to say we're saved and still look like the world. Yeah. Why would the world come into the church if it's the same mess they see on the outside? He did not leave us in a body that was still a slave to sin. So many of us have been taught for so long that as long as we in this flesh body, we're going to mess up. Newsflash. That's not scriptural. But let me give you a key point. Christ gave us everything we need to be successful. Don't get it twisted. When I traded places with Christ, because he took my filthy life and gave me his righteousness, I took upon his nature. And I have to make sure that I let him grow up in me, because we get him in. And the more you deny yourself, the more he grows in you. The more you begin to say, Lord, I'll trust you. Though you slay me, I will trust you. Although this looks like I'm defeated, I'm going to trust you, growing God. The more he stands up in you. I was so encouraged when I was here on Tuesday night to hear Pastor Decker give a small testimony. He didn't even go into detail, but he was all in this sermon. When he talked about he had a situation that was going on, somebody was in his face, and he held his peace. How many of us can do that? How many of us can do that? And I applaud you, women, so guess what? You're supposed to be helping the next woman to know how to do that in times of adversity. The scripture that's taught to say, as long as we're in this flesh body, we don't mess up, is the one that says that in the flesh dwells no good thing. That's why the Bible tells you in that scripture we just read, walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit. Because that scripture was talked about the unsaved, ungenerated man. But once we receive Christ, now, understand this. Don't get it twisted. I'm not a slave to sin anymore, but I still can sin if I want to. But I don't want to. I don't want to. Because I know it hurts God. I know he wants me to be all that he created me to be. So in those times when I'm tempted, in those times when I'm at a point where the enemy puts something in my path to get me off, but I'm going to trust you through. If I can't do nothing else but praise you, let me explain to you the reason why the wings of an eagle is so important. The eagle sees a storm long before it gets there. And the eagle takes flight and goes above.
see and don't see. Sometimes it's hard to hear and don't hear. Now I'm going to explain to you what I mean when I say that. There are going to be situations that's going to occur. Some of us have experienced with our children.
Yes, God.
They didn't do what we told them they should do. And they chose to go their own way. And you look at it and say, I love my baby. That occurred in my own life that God prepared me for. But even though he prepared me for it, it still hit me emotionally. And I kept saying, Lord, why? Why am I still going through this emotionally? He said, because you got to tell your story to help some woman and don't know what to do with it. In those times when you don't know what to do, rise above the storm. If you don't do nothing else but get in a warfare praise. When somebody brings you the worst new possible, begin to confuse the enemy and say, Lord, no, you're training. Yes, well, I trust you. No, this looks like I'm going down. Yes, well, I trust you. God has changed the whole time. Show them who you are. Show them who you are. Glory to God. And it's not in your own strength that you will do this. You cannot. If you think you gonna do it, you're gonna fail. Because most times what happens is when somebody try to get crazy with us, the enemy try to come in and he say, go with him. Yeah, get with him, get with him. They all up in your face. But let me tell you, that's a setup. Because it's only the word of God that's going to sustain you in it.
the word of God that's going to keep you when you need to be kept. And you, and I heard another lady say, you can't get out what you never put in. So many of us put in everything else but the word of God. Don't just come to church on Sunday. Come to Bible study on Tuesday. And don't study your word throughout the week. That's like having two meals for the week. And that's it. You need a spiritual meal every day. Sometimes two and three times a day. Depending on what's going on with you. Depending on what you're faced with. The Bible tells us to pray without ceasing. And when we're able to do that, things will come and we will begin to look at it and say, Lord, I'm going to trust you. When you're in a place where you're being unfairly treated on your job and you don't know what to do with that, rise above the situation. Don't put your mouth on it. Don't say out of your mouth what you see physically. Because if the setup, Bible says that we are snared and taken by the words of our mouth. Many times we set up our own situation by speaking over it. There are times I'll mention something to my husband, and we do this back and forth to each other. And he'll say, no, that ain't gonna happen. I said, oh. We ain't gonna speak over it. And we ain't gonna speak right over it. We ain't gonna say nothing. Because your words create your world. And if what you're saying ain't lining up with the word, man, you got some world news. Because the enemy gonna make sure you don't get in the word. He gonna make sure that you're not gonna show them that you are a son of God. And let me show you, I don't want you to get caught up in me saying the son of God. We are mankind. And remember I told you we're man with a womb.
Yes, I love it.
So when God says the sons of God, he's including us too.
Yes, he is.
Because you know the Bible says that when you're in Christ, there's no male nor female.
That's right.
Greek nor Jew.
That's right.
Slave nor free.
Yes.
So it goes out of the window. So when people start saying you a female, it don't matter. It's Christ that's living in me that's preaching. It's Christ that's living in me that's teaching the word of God. Many of us were taught by our mothers, but they didn't preach. My mama did preach though. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Let me tell you something. When you begin to know who you are,
yes.
You, whatever it is you're going through, I don't care what it is you've done, know that Christ died for that.
Hallelujah.
Every sin, everything that could ever be done under the sun, Christ died for it. He took it all to the cross. And it's time that we show them who we are.
Yes.
You are a virtuous woman. If you're a man, then you are a mighty man of God. And it's time for us to stand up. It's time for us to rise up and show them who we are. In times of adversity, we should stand and see the salvation of the Lord. When somebody is telling you off, but God is saying, trust me, don't say nothing back.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sometimes it's hard.
Yes,
it's hard. It's so hard.
Yes, it is.
But let me tell you something. When Jesus went to the cross, it looked like it was ultimate defeat. The disciples were so outdone, they didn't know what to do. They were saying, we thought it was the one. But they forgot what he told them. He said, on the third day, I'll rise again. Olivia say, I give it 3 days. 3 days. Because let me tell you something, it's a setup when you put yourself in isolation. Because what happened is, your sister can't come to you and say, girl, the devil talking to your mind. When you're in isolation, so much stuff can happen. You know, when somebody left to their own thoughts, oh Lord. If you ever talk to anybody who's been left to their own thoughts, Lord help. Because you're like, where are they coming up with this stuff? But I'm telling you, when you got
got a sister in your corner, she can tell you, hey, I know you've been under attack. But come out of there. Because the longer you stay there, you know, when we get patients and they sick, we try to get them up as quickly as possible. Because what happens is that bed will suck the life out of you. It will suck the life out of you. And if the devil can keep you down long enough, he gonna suck the very life out of you. The Bible tells us that we will lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. So if we don't see the sick recovering, that's what it is. We're not laying hands.
My God, that's scripture.
Glory to God.
My God.
In times of adversity, we must stand and see the salvation of the Lord. The Lord is saying, and I'm telling you with such fervency, when things look so horrible, remember I told you, the disciples gave up. Peter said, he denied him three times because he was afraid. But had Peter known who he was, he wouldn't have had to deny him. And he would have trusted what Jesus said, that in 3 days he would rise again. It looked like ultimate defeat. So there are times our situation looked like we're defeated. There are times where God will let you have chaos on your job to move you out of there, and you look like you defeated, but then you get a call the next few days and they give you triple or double or quadruple or what you was making, and you say, look at God, look at this situation, only God could have done this. There are times when chaos comes to shove you out of your comfort zone. When they've been working with me for so long, and they say, you should have came in the door talking about you was a minister. I said, oh no. Because they start thinking, well, what I done said in front of her. And I tell them all the time, it matters not what you say in front of me. It's him. And if you saying it every day, baby, that's you. Then I had women telling me, it's because of you I didn't change. I said, no, baby, it's because of him. It's because of him. And so they would always tell me, I knew something was different about you. I just didn't know what it was. You always calm. I don't never hear you cuss nobody. I say, you don't hear me cuss nobody. Because blessings and curses ain't gonna come out of the same thing. Too many times we've been brought a situation and the enemy wants us to curse it with our mouths. To go left when we should have went right. To keep going where the devil been trying to take you. To keep going and getting in that person's face. How do you know that God is not trying to allow them to see the character of Christ in you? But you messing up. She trying to get me though. I got her number. Show them who you are!
questions. Many people lied on us. Many people said all manner of evil against us. I said, God, I will watch you fight my battle.
To help us sing this morning. Can y'all do that?